Wrap up starts and stops. The federal perjury trial for one of Maryland's former top cops moves into the defense phase. I'm Erin Burnett, and I'm just back from the courtroom. The latest coming up.
Things will heat up at the Xfinity Center tonight when Maryland basketball takes the court. But Coach Willard wants fans to chill and savor the flavor. I'm Jesse Schwartz, and I'll have the scoop. CNS-TV News starts. One step closer to the truth. Documents revealed and accusations on full display as Baltimore's former state's attorney prepares to possibly take the stand. I'm Tallulah Payajayi.
And how a Supreme Court decision could potentially reverse protection for victims of domestic violence. I'm Olivia Wolfson, and this is CNS-TV. A hectic day in court today as the prosecution in the trial of Baltimore City's former state's attorney laid out its case. Erin Burnett was in the courtroom. And the back and forth between prosecutors and defense created for theatrics, to say the least.
Yeah, Olivia, it really did. There's been a lot of twists and turns in this case, so bear with me. Well, the second day of trial got a very slow and dragged out start today as the prosecution wrapped up its case against Marilyn Mosby with final testimony from FBI forensic financial analyst Jenna Bender. Several of Mosby's financial and business documents swirled through the courtroom today, one of which was Mosby's own voice in the form of a recorded phone call between Mosby and Nationwide, the administrator of her 401k plan that she allegedly lied in order to pull money from. The prosecution says she was able to pull this money after applying for the CARES Act during COVID-19. That act gave people the ability to withdraw money during the pandemic due to pandemic-related hardships. The defense then began to set up its case that there's no evidence Mosby even knew about the complexities of the CARES Act in order to lie about it. Now, here's where it gets a little testy. As defense witnesses were called to the stand today, the prosecution objected several times, saying their testimony was hearsay and a distraction from what prosecutors say was Mosby's pure dishonesty. Over the course of the trial, 12 jurors will decide whether Mosby knowingly lied on her application in order to obtain the funds, which she allegedly used to buy properties in Florida. With so many twists and turns, one major issue for a jury is digesting a very complex case with complex legal arguments from both sides that aren't as simple if you don't really have a legal degree. One legal professor gave his opinions on how this would affect the jury.
I think you always have to be concerned with whether the jury is maintaining its attention, and that's why the judge is taking many breaks. But when you have testimony that's not as exciting and as vivid, it challenges everyone to keep awake.
How long will this trial take, and what's next?
Yeah, the trial was supposed to wrap up around Thanksgiving, 2 weeks from now, but it may not take that long despite how it's slow it started. Tomorrow, Marilyn Mosby may take the stand herself, and if she does, the prosecution says they will be testing the full scope of her honesty, questioning her on other situations in which she might not have been completely honest or told the truth, including issues with her taxes, her mortgage, and civil contempt in the Keith Davis Jr. trial. We'll keep you updated on all of the happenings as the case may finally have hit the fast lane.
Erin Burnett keeping close watch on this trial. Thank you, Erin.
Thanks.
Today's general election is in full swing, and there are some key races impacting Marylanders. Five candidates are running for mayor in Laurel to replace longtime seat holder Craig Moe. Moe is the city's longest tenured mayor, serving 21 years in the position. Voters in Laurel will also vote to fill five council seats. In Bowie and Rockville, voters will elect a mayor from two possible candidates and city council members.
Races in other states very well could be a preview of what's to come in next year's presidential election. Our Carl McManus joins us from the newsroom. Carl, abortion's at the forefront again.
Olivia, it sure is. Abortion is at the center of three of the biggest races today. Voters will determine if these three states will limit or expand abortion access. In Virginia, the vote today may determine who controls the Commonwealth's General Assembly. And the party that wins the state Senate historically does well in the next potential presidential election. The GOP currently holds a majority in the House, but Democrats have a 22-18 advantage in the Senate. Republican Governor Glenn Youngkin wants to flip at least two seats. That would help to advance his agenda, including a proposed bill that would change the current restrictions from abortion from 26 weeks to just 15 weeks. A question on ballots in Ohio could constitutionalize abortion rights in the state. Abortion is currently legal in Ohio up to 22 weeks, but the proposed amendment to the ballot today in Ohio would establish, quote, an individual right to one's own reproductive medical treatment, including but not limited to abortion. Voting yes would constitutionalize the amendment and follow a trend of red and swing states voting to uphold abortion rights since Roe v. Wade was overturned. Voters in Kentucky, meanwhile, are deciding the state's next governor, incumbent Democrat Andy Beshear against Republican Attorney General Daniel Cameron. The race positions two candidates with opposing views on abortion rights. Beshear has voted down multiple abortion bans since he says he supports reasonable restrictions. Cameron, on the other hand, supports a total ban on abortion unless the mother's health is at risk. What voters decide in these three states will serve as indicators as candidates run for House and Senate positions in the next presidential election. Each party hoping to defeat the other, push forward their own agenda, and break the stalemates that have crippled Congress this term. Reporting live from the newsroom, I'm Carl McManus. Tululupe, back to you.
Thanks, Carl. Some Virginia voters are dodging wildfires tonight. Governor Glenn Youngkin declared a state of emergency in Virginia yesterday as the flames continue to spread. Youngkin's executive order allows the Commonwealth to mobilize resources and first responders needed to combat the wildfires currently affecting two counties. With peak dry conditions and high winds, Virginia's fall fire season lasts until November 30th, and Youngkin's order will stay in place for 30 days. The fires broke containment lines over the weekend, prompting Youngkin's decision, made hours before Election Day in Virginia.
Well, in response to the ongoing slew of carjackings in D.C., officials are providing dash cams to delivery and rideshare drivers. District leaders and DoorDash teamed up to give out free dash cams to eligible drivers to improve worker safety. The initiative comes after two delivery drivers were carjacked over the weekend and one was shot. The Metropolitan Police Department claims there have been over 800 carjackings this year in D.C., which is more than double than the district had at this time last year.
There's a new chief in town. The D.C. Council has voted to confirm Acting Police Chief Pamela Smith to officially lead the Metropolitan Police Department. Today, the council unanimously advocated for Smith's leadership at a time where the district is desperate to tackle record-high crime.
This confirmation comes at a critical time for both the district and the Metropolitan Police Department. The district faces significant increases in violent crime and property crime, while MPD similarly faces officer hiring and retention issues. I believe that she has the ability, the experience, and the commitment necessary to do this job well.
Smith began the role of interim chief in July after former Chief Robert Conte retired. Smith is now the first Black woman to reach this position in MPD's 162 years.
And tonight, a new and somewhat controversial plan is on the table to revitalize Baltimore's Inner Harbor. CNS's Michael Levitsky joins us live from the Inner Harbor with details. Michael?
Yeah, Olivia. Inner Harbor has been sinking for some time now. Businesses closing, patronage down, the pandemic making things even worse. A new plan would feature four new buildings, two of them luxury apartment towers. The promenade would get a facelift and there would be a new large park. Roadways would be reconfigured to make access more driver and pedestrian friendly. But this mixed-use plan is not getting rave reviews from everyone. Some questioning the cost of living and doing business, saying it shuts out Baltimore residents. Others saying they are ready to embrace the change.
Some change would be good for Baltimore, maybe. You know, it'll encourage more tourists to come by. In addition to that, you know, people want to appreciate the city more, you know, leave less trash, take care of it a little bit better. You know, new things give an incentive to people to want to take care of it better.
Prices get higher, then ain't nobody gonna come down here because the living is different down here. You know, food prices getting higher, gas getting higher. So what next? We gonna have all these big old high rises and what, they gonna be high, $5,600. And I don't have that type of money. I got $1.
Now the price tag of this proposed project is steep. Over $400 million of public funds are being asked from the developer. But in the meantime, we will keep you posted. Olivia Tulupe, reporting live from Baltimore City's Inner Harbor. Now back to you in the studio.
Thanks, Michael. the universe's oldest mystery may have just been solved.
And should abusers keep their Second Amendment rights? Only a Supreme Court decision will tell. We'll explain when we come back.
Zaki Rahimi's case brought this issue to the court. He was
My biggest takeaway would be that CNS is definitely a professional news environment, and I'm kind of being treated as such, so this is my first time reporting like that, so I'm pretty excited, and I know by the end of it, I'll be ready to launch my career.
More than anything, CNS is just, it's a really great learning opportunity. Every week we're presented with a new challenge. We have to tackle it together as a team, and something like that, it's just a really great positive experience for everyone, and that's why it's so important to me. When it all comes together beautifully and together, it's great. It's a great feeling because you know that everyone chipped in to do it.
When I never graduated from high school, I realized I wanted to go back to school because I didn't want to work these backbreaking jobs the rest of my life. With the help of my father and having my son, that was all the motivation that I needed to come back to school. I felt accomplished. It made me feel that I could take on whatever challenges life throws at you.
Find free adult education classes near you at finishyourdiploma.org.
CNS-TV. Today, the Supreme Court heard arguments that could determine the future of gun rights and protecting domestic abuse victims. It's currently illegal for someone under a domestic violence restraining order to own a gun under federal law. However, this could now be overturned. I spoke with Turnaround Clinic today, which is the main rape crisis and domestic violence center in Baltimore, about what this decision could mean for the future.
Zaki Rahimi's case brought this issue to the court. He was convicted in Texas for still owning guns after allegedly assaulting his girlfriend. His case has gotten the attention of domestic violence prevention advocates who want the Supreme Court to uphold the law, saying people under restraining orders should not be allowed to own guns, while gun rights advocates want the court to overturn that law. Rahimi argues that the law violates his Second Amendment rights. Amanda Rodriguez is the director of Turnaround Clinic in Baltimore and works with domestic abuse victims every day. She says that if the law is overturned, it could have dangerous consequences.
Us, right? We've studied it enough in public health that we understand that folks that have guns in domestic violence situations in their homes are more likely to die at the hands of their abuser. And so it is really important to realize that there's a fivefold increase of the potential of someone dying if there's a gun in the house.
She says it could also impact people not directly involved in these situations.
We have children that are impacted, neighbors that come and try to help that are impacted. So this is absolutely a community issue, and we have to keep our community safe, which means that we have to make sure that when we know that they'll be safe or without guns in the home, that we protect them from that.
The court expanded gun rights last year after saying that gun laws have to agree with the history and traditions of the country. However, after today, the court seems to agree that this law does uphold this, as Justice Jackson points out issues with the test.
A little troubled by having a history and traditions test that also requires some sort of culling of the history so that only certain people's history counts.
And it's arguments like this one that has experts saying the Supreme Court is likely to side with federal law barring people under domestic violence restraining orders from owning a gun. However, the Supreme Court won't have an actual decision until June or July.
The second Colorado police officer was found not guilty in the death of Elijah McClain, a 23-year-old unarmed black man who died after police put him in a chokehold and paramedics injected him with ketamine in 2019. Yesterday, a jury found the officer not guilty of homicide and manslaughter following a week-long trial. Two of the three officers who faced trial so far have avoided prison time, leaving McClain's mother still searching for justice.
My son was murdered by killer cops and their accomplices. And the system, the justice system, allows for them to continue with their crimes.
McClain's mother sat in the front row of the courtroom and left with her fist raised in the air, just like she did after the first trial last month.
Well, today marks 1 month since the Hamas attack in Israel. A month ago, Hamas fired rockets which killed over 1,000 and kidnapped 240 people. The Israel-Hamas war continues to rage on as the Hamas-run health ministry says more than 10,000 Palestinians have been killed. The war has become the deadliest Israeli-Palestinian violence since Israel was established 75 years ago.
An elderly man is dead following an altercation at an Israel-Hamas war protest. Paul Kessler, a 69-year-old Jewish man from California, attended a pro-Israel protest on Sunday. At the same time, just across the street, pro-Palestinian citizens hosted another protest. Kessler died of blunt force trauma to the skull and suffered from skull fractures, swelling, and bruising of the brain, leading to his death, which has been ruled a homicide. Authorities have not ruled out the possibility of the incident being a hate crime and are still investigating what led to the deadly altercation. Investigators are asking for any footage bystanders may have captured of the incident.
Long ago in a galaxy far, far away, NASA scientists have discovered the oldest black hole to date, confirming the theory that the supermassive black holes have existed since the universe was created. The James Webb Space Telescope captured images of the astronomical void and calculated its age to be more than 13 billion years old, meaning it was formed just 470 million years after the Big Bang. The telescope was created and is run by the Space Telescope Science Institute in Baltimore.
Michael Kirsting is next with sports.
Big night in College Park, Michael.
Yeah, Tulalipe, Olivia, huge night here in College Park. We're hitting the hardwood. Basketball is back. The Terps look to come out fighting as Coach Kevin Willard looks to elevate his team this season. Tip-off is in under 2 hours, and we'll have a live report after this.
Eva Marie smoked 12,000 packs of cigarettes over 15 years. She quit, and now there's a new lung cancer screening that could save her life. You stopped smoking, now start screening. No matter how much you smoked, early detection could save you. Talk to your doctor or learn more at savedbythescan.org.
After the weekend we've had, Maryland fans are relieved to finally have something to be excited about because it's basketball season.
That's right, Tulupe. Michael Kirsting joins us to break down the season, and there's a lot to look forward to, right, Michael?
Yeah, that's right, Tulupe and Olivia. One of the longest off seasons in American sports finally ends tonight, and Maryland men's basketball fans' thirst for college basketball will finally be quenched as the season begins in just a couple hours. Our Ricky Podgorski is at the Xfinity Center for Maryland men's basketball regular season opener. How's the vibe over there, Ricky?
Yeah, Michael, a lot of excitement in the air tonight here at Xfinity Center. These fans will start to fill in very shortly to catch the tip-off to the 2023-24 Maryland men's basketball season. Now, the Terps will take on Mount St. Mary's here at Gary Williams Court very shortly, and there's a lot of noise around Kevin Willard's squad. We'll start with some of the veterans. Three-year big man Juju Reese comes back for another year, and two fifth-years, Jameer Young and Dante Scott, make their return as well. Head coach Willard says that Jameer Young is poised for a breakout season, saying that a year under his system and in the Big Ten will help him make that next step this year. But these veterans have a tall task ahead of them as they will have to lead one of the best recruiting classes in the entire country. Freshman headlining this group is Deshaun Harris-Smith out of Paul VI, a combo point guard who will complement Jameer Young well in the backcourt. Rounding out this team, Kevin Willard did some work in the transfer portal, grabbed 7-footer Matty Traore out of New Mexico State, and a big man from Big Ten foe Indiana, Jordan Geronimo. Geronimo will bring that Big Ten experience to this new-look roster. Clearly, a lot of moving parts and pieces to this squad, but head coach Kevin Willard is most excited to see how these pieces work together tonight against the Mount.
Against a veteran team that knows how to run their stuff. That's the biggest thing I'm looking for, is see when we get different lineups in there that we haven't played with, you know, how they react.
The Terps played some of their best basketball last season in this building, going undefeated in Big Ten conference play. And Michael, I am so excited to see how this team will rebound from last year to this year and play again here at home. Most importantly, though, I'm excited to see how this team will mesh all together for once and for all against the Mount.
Yeah, Ricky, you can feel the anticipation all around campus. Team being high up in the rankings, undefeated season last year. We'll be seeing how Coach Willard and company kick things off in year two. Thanks, Ricky. And while the Terps start their success this season, the Baltimore Orioles are being rewarded for theirs this past season. The Baseball Writers Association nominated Gunnar Henderson and Brandon Hyde as finalists for Rookie of the Year and Manager of the Year, respectively. In addition, GM Mike Elias was named Executive of the Year by his peers just a few hours ago. The O's won 100 games for the first time in 43 seasons, an extremely far cry from losing 110 games just two seasons ago. The winner of the Rookie of the Year will be announced Monday, and the Manager of the Year on Tuesday. Back to the district, the Washington Capitals will wrap up a nice five-game homestand tomorrow night against the Carolina Panthers. The Caps have won four of their last five games while at Capital One. And while they'll be happy with their recent form, their leader Alex Ovechkin knows they can still get a little better.
Every game we play better and better, offensively, defensively. But how I said, power play didn't work well right now for us, you know. But you can see all that, you know, like we can score goals. We score two a game. It's not enough, and if you want to win the games.
Ovi knows better than anybody that goals win games, and he said earlier that he likes the direction the team is moving in right now. You could call Ovi the Batman of Washington hockey, but he may be without his metaphorical Robin for the foreseeable future. Last week, fellow Caps fan favorite Nicholas Backstrom announced he would be stepping away from the team to focus on nursing his ailing hip back to full strength. Yesterday, Caps GM Brian McClellan addressed the media for the first time regarding Backy stepping away.
I would say it's unlikely. Yeah, I mean, it's a tough one. I mean, you watch his progression here over the last 2+ years. I mean, it's been a long process that, you know, I think it's been hard on him mentally and emotionally. I mean, we'll give him time and space and support. You know, I expect him to see him around, working out, you know, being around the guys. I don't know that we can describe how much he's meant to the organization.
Now over to the gridiron, a successful victory week feels good for any player, but nobody's going to be feeling better than Ravens running back Keaton Mitchell coming into this week. Mitchell was given a chance to split touches with starter Gus Edwards against the Seahawks, and boy, did he make the most of it. He rushed for 138 yards on just 9 carries. Oh, and oh, by the way, he scored his first career touchdown. Coach John Harbaugh sang his praises for Mitchell when speaking to the media yesterday.
Man, the guys are so excited for him, you know, and he's a guy that's been just working every day, and he has a great attitude. Just finally getting an opportunity at this point in time, mid-season already, he finally gets a chance and makes the most of it. So
Mitchell helped the Ravens cruise to a 37-3 victory over the Seahawks, and we'll see how he continues to leave an impact on the running game going forward. Who knows? Maybe this is the start of an incredible story. And hey, Tulalipe Olivia, these are my favorite kinds of stories. When a guy out of nowhere just comes in, kicks off, and gets a season going. Could be a really, really important ad for the Ravens.
Yeah, I honestly wanted to go to the Ravens game this weekend, and I missed it. So I'm sad that I missed such a cool moment. But I am very excited for basketball to start.
Yeah, unlike football games, I usually stay for the entirety of basketball games, yeah. So I'm excited to pretend to be a sports fan again.
Agreed. But you know what's almost as good as the beginning of college basketball season? If you said a new flavor of ice cream, you're right. We'll explain what it has in common with the Terps tip-off. And sometimes we experience weather from two seasons in 1 month, but fasten your seatbelts for some faster weather swings this week.
Jesse Schwartz has a look ahead. Jesse?
Yeah, I mean, this time of year always has some pretty crazy weather swings.
But this month, and especially this week, more so than ever, I can't decide if I should grab my coat, my fan each morning. Your forecast is coming up after the break.
More than anything, CNS is just, it's a really great learning opportunity. Every week we're presented with a new challenge. We have to tackle it together as a team, and something like that, it's just a really great positive experience for everyone, and that's why it's so important to me. When it all comes together beautifully and together, it's great. It's a great feeling because you know that everyone chipped in to do it.
The black truck? Hey, Christina from accounting.
Yeah, hi.
Hey, I used to date a girl named Christina.
Oh, really?
Yeah, and then she dumped me for my best friend. You want to see some photos of them that I took?
I don't.
I thought we talked about this, buddy.
Buzz and overshared again?
Yeah.
Yeah. I'm going to call a car.
That's a smart idea.
So, yeah, I know. That's why I did it.
Hey, you're going to get back to the top of the mountain.
Does that mean I'm going to get back with Christina?
No.
Oh.
No.
Mi mamá la deportaron, no sentía que tenía la motivación para seguir estudiando. Mi esposo es un gran apoyo para mí, porque desde el principio él siempre me ha apoyado que yo regresara a la escuela. Mi hija y mi hijo son lo que a mí me hacen vivir. Las cosas que pensé que no podía lograr, lo estoy haciendo. Por eso le digo a todos que también ellos lo pueden lograr.
Encuentra clases gratis para adultos cerca de ti en completatudiploma.org.
Coats on, coats off.
The weather seems to be all over the place, doesn't it, Jesse?
Yeah, Olivia. I mean, I'm not going to complain because I do like the warm weather, but it has been crazy this weather to start November. Today, we had a really nice day. It was a high of about 70. Right now, 65 degrees outside. Warm. It's really nice. I really enjoyed the day. I mean, obviously, it's getting dark now, so it's going to start to cool down. But for November, to be able to wear shorts, a t-shirt, that's a big thumbs up for me. Now we're going to move on to tonight, where it is going to cool down. It's going to get to 43 degrees, which for this time of year, I would say is still really, really enjoyable. You can go out, not be freezing. If you're going to take a walk around, maybe go pick up some food. You put a coat on and you'll be comfortable. So now going into the rest of the week, it's interesting because we are going to stay warm for a few days. We're going to look at the radar to see what's coming in for the next few days. You can see there's some weather moving in. It's going to be warm the next few days, but you can see that hopefully a little bit of a storm system might come in and give some rain to the weekend. Although the nice weather, temps are going to fall as you see this move in. So looking at the next couple days, tomorrow's going to be about 10, 15 degrees cooler than it was today. It'll still be super nice, sunny weather, 61 degrees, something everyone will enjoy if you like being outside, spend the day outside. Thursday, a high of around 76. That's getting close to record-breaking temperatures. The record for this time of year, 79 degrees on that day. So we should watch that, see if we come close, because 76 is going to be a really warm Thursday. But enjoy it while it lasts, because it is going to cool down, guys. The rest of the weekend, only going to be in about the high 50s, mid-50s. And Friday, some rain, which normally on the weather forecast, no one's very excited about. But with the weather we've had recently, there's droughts everywhere, as we talked about. Virginia now in a state of emergency. So hopefully that weather really does roll in and we get some rain in these areas that really need it. That will kick off a fairly sunny weekend. A little cool, but the sun will warm it up. And I think everyone can have some nice plans for this weekend and enjoy it. Olivia Tolulipe. You can see,
I've taken out every single type of clothing in the past week or two, so excited to see where this takes us next.
Yeah, I mean, that's 76 degrees coming up, so I have to bring my shorts out again.
Yeah.
This is annoying.
Just to put on a sweater the next day, it's interesting. Mm. Well, a coach finally gets his Maryland Dairy debut.
And it comes right in time as he takes on his second season as a Terp. A tasty preview next. My name's Olivia Wolfson, and I'm a senior. And my biggest takeaway would be that CNS is definitely a professional news environment, and I'm kind of being treated as such. So this is my first time reporting like that, so I'm pretty excited. And I know by the end of it, I'll be ready to launch my career.
Maryland basketball fans are excited to support the team on the court starting this week, but they have the chance to support them off the court too, in a tasty way. Head coach Kevin Willard's new ice cream flavor is officially available at Maryland Dairy.
When people talk about Maryland fans having something to look forward to this week, the first thought is that the excitement is aimed towards the hardwood.
They're ready for basketball season.
But there is something else they can look forward to. Willard's full court press.
I thought it was good, interesting.
It kind of reminds me of like a peanut, like a adjacent to peanut butter and jelly.
More of a chocolate guy personally, but I thought it worked pretty well.
It was really good and I liked the peanut butter.
Not a coaching strategy, but his introduction to a Maryland Dairy tradition that honors Terps coaches. It's the release of men's basketball head coach Kevin Willard's new ice cream flavor.
Each coach gets to create an ice cream flavor that's unique to their own taste. They start with an ice cream flavor base and then add in toppings that Maryland Dairy has to offer before giving it a clever name. For Coach Willard, he picked a black raspberry ice cream base and added in peanut butter cup pieces.
I was a kid, I used to go to Friendly's ice cream after basketball practice. And if I played good, I would get a Reese's Pieces sundae, and that's where it came from.
While Maryland students enjoyed the ice cream,
this would be my go-to.
They weren't quite sure exactly why they were being given a surprise tasty treat.
I can't tell you what his name is.
No idea.
Is it a basketball coach's flavor?
I do. It's the basketball coach, Kevin Willard.
And whether students recognize him in an apron, in the student union, he looks forward to their support when the team steps on the court.
They were unbelievable last year, and we need them out again.
But off the court, he will continue to give his support back through a little dessert.
There was one of the first people up there, and he gave me the ice cream, and he noticed my band jacket, and I was like, that's so nice.
It makes everyone smile, and that was the whole goal.
Jesse Schwartz, CNS-TV News.
While fans come from all over the DMV to visit the Xfinity Center and watch the Terps play some basketball, they can extend their trip with a visit to Maryland Dairy to see what they think of the newest flavor. What do you think, Jesse? I didn't get a chance to try it, but
I got to agree with everyone who said it tastes kind of like PB&J. I thought it was going to be weird. I liked it a lot more than I thought. I did try to bring back communal ice cream for everyone. It doesn't seem to be as
pink. The color's kind of off-putting.
Yeah,
I can't lie.
I agree. I don't know if I'm a big enough PB&J girl to, like, enjoy that. But you know what?
I mean, I'm so happy you brought back.
The consensus was that it was pretty good, though, so we'll see.
Yeah.
But make sure you check us out online at cnsmaryland.org and follow us on Twitter at cns-md.
You can find us on Facebook at facebook.com/MarylandCNS and on YouTube at CNS Maryland.
Thank you for joining us. Have a good evening.